title of the thing is why jazz is interesting. It's very biased. I'm not claiming any sort of truth or ground truth or whatever. It's just my opinion. But the goal is I have to spend a bit, 1 minute on the goal. I think one, I don't know, maybe some of you know about jazz and they have a girlfriend, and the girlfriend doesn't understand what this is about, and it really, this dialogue is impossible. And you play jazz, you bring her to concert, you play maybe yourself, and she's really bored, and there is nothing you can do. Or maybe it's the opposite, you are a girl, you have boyfriends, or all sorts of combinations like that, but the dialogue is not possible. And it happens in life in many domains. It seems that in jazz it's a bit different, because in jazz it seems to me that there are objective reasons that why you could like jazz. There are not only objective reasons you could like it because, I don't know, for reasons that you are not able to articulate, of course, or a mix. But there are some objective reasons, and in this audience of computer scientists, or let's say scientists in the large, I thought it was interesting to try to pinpoint them and show you why jazz is interesting for people like you and me. And so I will try to give some doors. I mean, again, I'm not going to be exhaustive. I will talk only about the kind of things I like or I find interesting. It doesn't mean that there are not other ones, of course. Please be, let's say, patient with me if I don't talk about your favorite musician. And also the goal is to make some link with me at the end, maybe. With the idea that if you want to do a MIR system for a particular kind of music, let's say jazz, maybe it's interesting to know what it's about, what are the actually important things going on there, and maybe they have nothing to do with other styles like baroque music or that kind of thing. So I don't know any MIR system today really specific to jazz, but I think it could be one because it's a very interesting area to investigate. And I will try to show you some concept with the guitar because it's more lively, otherwise everybody sleeps and after lunch. Also, yeah, why jazz? Again, I know about it, and it's a very interesting case. I mean, the music industry is collapsing, as you know, and but jazz is actually going pretty well. There are lots of niche markets in jazz. There is a very, very strong community of people very actively looking for concerts, also looking for pedagogy. They want to learn how to play, because they think this guy is playing great, they want to learn like him. It's extremely alive. I mean, it's not like there are other kinds of music where it's not the case, and jazz is incredibly alive. Actually, myself, I'm very surprised to see the number of very young people today, extremely talented, that pop up here and there and on YouTube and all that. And in fact, what I would like to say in this soil, jazz is a bit like a scientific community, a good scientific community should be. That is, it's a community that is very, very related. I mean, everyone is related to each other, and the past is cited all the time, like in papers, you know, good papers should quote old papers and that kind of thing. Bad papers never get cited, good papers get, and that kind of thing to learn to do. And in jazz, it's a bit like that. So there is it's an evolving field. It's a very robust field because they build up on each other. It's not going in circle. It's really evolving. It seems that it's going forward. I don't know where, but and I would like to show a bit why I think that this is true, and with some examples. And if you go on YouTube and see what's going on, there is an incredible amount of videos of people saying, okay, there is how this guy plays this lick in D minor, and lots of people look at that, so there is a huge activity there. And I think it's interesting for me also to understand what it is and maybe help and do something about it. Jazz is also a skill. It's a skill that requires a lot of technique to learn for, I don't know, 15 years is enough probably to start. And but it's also an intellectual game, and to me, I mean, I see it a bit as a sport, actually. It's something where you have to go very fast with your body, it has to be very synchronized, but you have to think a lot also at the same time. So it's a very special activity, because you are doing with real time and improvisation. There is a guy called Holbrooke, who is a very quite famous, a bit controversial, he's an economist, who has written an interesting book where he said that, the skills that the jazz jazz because they are very interesting in many contexts like management. One of the key things that you learn in jazz is called negotiating the changes. You know, you have chords, I will try to show some examples of what it means. You have chords coming up, you can see them as external constraints, and you have to negotiate them, you have to surf on them, like a surf, when you surf on waves. And it requires a very specific kind of skill that you have to train a lot to do that. But there are, these skills are probably very useful in life, I mean, in many situations. So there are lots of reasons why you would be interested in that. And this is what I want to show, is to show you where it happens and how and all that. So I thought I do tutorial jazz, I have to do this very boring thing of explaining the history of jazz. Not for me, I'm not able to do that. I'm not interested in the history of jazz. There are 2 million books about it. So I will just, but still I have to do a kind of, what is the thing that is called jazz? So the idea is that, you know, I will try to be very, very, very crude approximation of what it's about. So in the first part, there will be 3 parts here. First part is the basic, the things which are required to understand what it's about. I will try to make them as interesting as possible, but it's... And then there is the second part that will say, what are the really interesting things? But then you have to know a bit about the basics to understand them. And then in the third part, I will talk a bit about the computer science and its sphere. And I will do a break, I don't know when you have enough. Maybe after the first part also. So what is jazz? There are lots of genres of jazz. Okay, there is a list. This is boring. There are lots of people today playing. It's not a dead genre. It's alive. It's a genre which is alive. It's very. I don't have any idea what's going on today in jazz. I would not be able to reify the current genres that are evolving, but there are current genres evolving. Very, very good people, extremely talented. It's a bit like ISMIR. I was speaking with yesterday. People are better and better technically at ISMIR if you compare 10 years ago. But jazz is the same today. People 14 years old, they play like Charlie Parker or whatever, or John Gordon. I mean, this was not the case before. It may be thanks to internet. So there are lots of styles. So what I will say to show the variety of styles, I will take one song. I will do it twice. I will do another song. So this song is called The Sentimental Mood. And this is a version by John Gordon, which dates from the 40s. So I will just play a little bit. Do you know this? Who does not know this tune? Everybody knows it? No. Okay. So this is how the people in jazz would play in the 40s. Gypsy, kind of called jazz manouche, gypsy jazz. Simple rhythm section, emphasizing all the beats. Each chord is on the beat, and then the improvisation. This is not as great as improvisation, but it's very linear. It's you know, quarter notes, eighth notes, sixteenth notes. Sometimes there are triplets, but everything really falls on the beat. It's really, for computer scientists, it's nice. I mean, you don't have freedom front with the this version later is interesting. I will come back on that. It's John Coltrane, but much later, in the late 50s. And Duke Ellington, you may know this guy, he's a big band arranger. And he made this version, which is very famous. It's one of the reference versions for people playing jazz. I will come back why later. So just play the interesting is the rhythm. So this thing is an invention of Duke Ellington. And it was not in the melody, but you can see jazz as a way, I mean, a way to detect a melody, take a tune, usually, and try to express something that is in that you think was hidden in the tune. So Ellington saw that this tune, which is very simple, it's almost a scale, it had somewhere in itself this da-da-da-da-da. Okay, so it added it, and it became a standard, because it was very, very well-known. I will play now something much more recent. It's the 80s, so it's a guy called Michael Brecker, it's a saxophone player. He's dead now. He was really a fantastic guy, very, very, very good, very inventive, very interesting. And he made a landmark version of the same song. I will play it from the beginning of the solo. I hope you can understand what's going on. He's playing with a niwi, with an electronic saxophone, MIDI. It's from 84, live concert in Tokyo, so it's much more recent. The sound is very different. And you can see the virtuosity of Brecker going, and then the kind of thing he tries to express in the same. Same old called One Century Old Tune. And this is really the game which is going on. And the game is not finished. The game of today, we will play this short extract by another much more recent, a few years ago. Stefano Di Battista is alive. He's very, he's probably one of the best sax players around today. He's Italian, French. And he's playing the chorus. I will show you now the dexterity, the virtuosity of those people playing all the time the same thing. But then he's going to incorporate some reference, some citations in his paper.
Completely
in harmony, but in a very fluid way. So if we can analyze this thing, I will explain why, how you can do that. Take a chord, C major, and you can play virtually anything, F sharp minor. The trick is to be able to bring it there and then to escape. So you can play this game with many tunes. There is another one I want to play now.
So this was the history of jazz.
jazz is a history which is very connected. Everything is connected to what was before. I mean, so far it was like that. So here I will try to focus on what I think is interesting there. It's not going to be the sound, it's not going to be the instrumentation, it's going to be really the focus on harmony and melody, because I think this is an entry point to get interested in all that. And of course, that means that the rest is not important. It is actually absolutely crucial to have good sound and all that. But the basic game is about harmony and the interplay between harmony and melody. So in jazz, you have references. The ISMIR proceedings is called the real book. In fact, it's a book, I don't bring one. It's a book which is 476 pages. Each page is more or less one stand-up, one song. There is the sentimental mood, there is autonomies and all that. And you have to know it to play, again, because it's not only songs, it's also versions. For each song, you know, many versions. And it is your background, it is your shared reference, and this is from where you are going to play and take ideas and possibly change them and transform them. There are many real books now. There is a Facebook, there is a whole collection of stuff. But it works really with a very shared common references that absolutely everybody knows. And also, everybody knows how to play each song in every key, not only in B flat minor, but in B minor and C minor, all that. This is why actually jazz sometimes it's difficult to play with other people. You have to try it out. So this is an example. So for those of you who don't know anything about jazz, I doubt there are any actually. It seems to me that many people here know that this is the kind of the thing you find in the real book. And you can keep one because I will come back later. It's one song called Stella Vefala, Twilight. And you see it's handwritten in the real book. There are not new versions, but so what it gives you basically, it gives you a melody.
Thank you.
side who knows that it's okay. So I want to talk a bit more about this game, because this is a central game, and we have to see our rules, you have to know, and then when you are very good, when you know all the rules, the game is to not to follow the rules. But there is a difference between knowing rules and not following them, and doing random stuff, as you may know if you do information theory. So the big game here, it's a bit strange, because at the end you can hear a solo, I will play some of them. And if you don't know that, you think this is strictly random stuff. I mean, the guy is just playing scales. It's like once I played with a guitar for left-handed, you know, it's almost like random. You don't know what you're doing. But no, these guys know exactly what they do. They play the wrong note all the time, but they know on purpose and they have intentions. And this is the game, of course. If there is no intention, it's not an interesting game. So basically, what you have is Stella by Stella, a chord structure, a chord grid, a chord sequence, a series of chords. And you have to find a melody that you can play on top of it. So you have to analyze it a little bit. I'm not going to spend hours on analysis, because in fact you have books on jazz harmony, big books, you have thousands of books, and I think they are not, you should not read them, because the basics of jazz harmony can be said in one slide, basically. So to show the slide, I need six slides before, but this is the central game is very, very simple how to do that. And so you have to analyze the grid to know what are the good notes, and also to understand the meaning, so to speak, of the chords, so that you can change them and play something else instead. So the thing is, it starts with scales, which is not very surprising, and actually in jazz, even the most sophisticated forms of jazz, we can live with only major scale and harmonic minor. And even major is probably not really necessary. Okay, so you know what's the scale, C major, Do, Re, Mi, Fa, Sol, La, Si, Do, and that kind of thing. C minor, you have some flats here and there. Okay, this you know probably more or less. Okay, don't need to know about it exactly. And then, you know, you have intervals. So you know intervals also. You have to have a very good ear, because intervals are not just integer, you know. They have a meaning. For instance, you have the unison interval. You do many things with unison. You have the minor second. Very dissonant, it can be very nice, so if you add other notes. Okay, so you hear a chord, you have to know what kind of interval there are there, which are interesting. I will play that. Dissonant, but this is nice. Okay, so you have to know these guys are your friends, basically. Major, second, you know. Minor third is the fundamental interval, because it's the basis of minor third. Okay. You can do diminished chords and everything. The minor third has a minor element. Fourth. I'm not going to teach you things you know already. What I want to tell you is that if you play jazz, you have to describe emotions. These guys are not just theoretical stuff. They are alive. You know them. The fourth. So the fourth for me is the thing which goes like. It's a resolution, something which goes from something. So. The fourth is the basic building block of resolutions. Augmented fourth. This one is nice. This is the most important in jazz. It's in tonal harmony. The augmented fourth is from going to C to F fourth to F sharp. Fourth is augmented. It's very dissonant. This one is fundamental. So it's also the tritone. So we spend some time on that. This one was considered a diabolus in musica in baroque music, so in fact you were not allowed, you could go to jail if you composed a piece with an explicit tritone and played explicitly. It was considered as absolutely evil. With jazz, people started, of course, to try to use it, because they thought it was, you know, subversive and all that. And this guy, when you hear tritone, I mean, it brings a lot of bad. One of them is Desafinado, a song by Tom Jobim. Okay. It's impossible. possible that you don't know the song for it. So where is the tritone there? There is a tritone. By the way, desafinado means, I think in Portuguese, out of tune. Yeah, that. Correct me if I'm wrong. So I do that. So there are other intervals. I will just finish this. So there are the fifth, like the fourth. I mean, you could. So you go to C. It's a fifth. It's not very interesting. Augmented fifth is more interesting. So you know, you go. Very useful in situation like this. When you have a fifth that goes up somewhere, I know. You can do it in minor also. The thing that moves inside the chord is the augmented fifth, very often, not all the time. Or something like this. keep talking. This is a big spark by me, like that.
Sound. I mean, harmonically, we're not talking about the sound of the guitar, of course, but the nine.
can be perfect like this, can be augmented.
Modulations.
In Java, you can do this in our library. It's just because we need here, so you take a chord, say C chord, C major, and can be first degree of C major and so forth, and you see that B diminished the last line can be only a seventh degree of C harmonic minus K. Okay. So you have the chord and you have the underlying possible scales. I skip this. So what is the analysis again? Well, you can find the scales that are minimum. So if you take autumn leaves, which you know probably the song, French organization, you take this kind of guide, and you will see there is not a single note to change. So I have done the basics. Sorry, maybe it was a bit slow. Now I'm going to do the interesting part. The thing is that once you know this, when you play like a student, and it's nice, but of course it's boring, and thousands of people have done it before you, and you listen to the record, and you are depressed. And you say, what? I cannot do that. There is something more. So here I want to talk about four things which make it more interesting, and which is actually, I think, the core, like, reasons why we listen to jazz and we try to play. First thing is this thing with negotiation. So I'll give you an example here. The thing is, this game of having chords which go fast and you surf on them, of course you have to know all that, but then you have to find a path which is continuous. You have to surf. You cannot just jump from one note to another. So you have to get this skill. This skill is the chord negotiation skill. I give you an example of Tyrell with a kind of, I don't know if he's really human, this guy. He can do that. Like this, and I hope that you will understand what's going on. So this is a tune called What a Little Mouse Can Do. It will start by a break and then provide exactly on that. I will follow with the mouse.
Thank you.
are interesting changes because there is a B there, B minor, and then at some point there is a B flat. So you should really negotiate this thing very, very well. Otherwise, the car is going to be thrown out of the way. And so the idea of what he's doing is taking all the chords and playing only minor chords. A minor is A minor. This one is G minor. We'll come back to that. This one is A minor. This one is already minor. But this can be all transformed into A harmonic minor. So we have this theory, which everything is basically a minor chord. And so what he has done for all his life is learn how to negotiate changes between two different minor chords, and that's it, you know. And with this, you can do everything. Absolutely everything. So it's one of the tricks that you can think about. Just playing the same chorus as Joe Di Francesco is doing.
Take the C, take the
Libra, this is the door open to many very interesting stuff. Well, there are lots of rules like this. Of course, some you know, like C major, this kind of same as A minor. It's the same as E minor. It's not the same, it's substitutable. And it's not very transitive. I mean, if you apply the rules more than three or four times, you can show easily that you can transform any chord into any other, and then you can really complete random. Okay. But to a certain extent, you can do that. And this game, we do it all the time as a second nature without actually thinking it in terms of algebra, of course. There is a very interesting one here, this one. This chord, you see, 7 flat 5, is very important because it appears actually in major scale. C major. It's almost diminished, not really diminished.
It's much more interesting. They're like, oh, all the time, and it seems it modulates all the time, and start by F and D, but then you go all the way to D minor, harmonic, and then you have this very nice thing, D minor, going to C minor, so you can do lots of nice stuff with this.
Thank you.
different, but there is a more important difference. This one, this thing is in C minor. The minor division thing is in C minor. Whereas the guy starts with a C major. Which is completely the same. Yeah. When you have a seventh chord with lots of stuff in it, like a sharp five and diminished nine, something like this. So usually it results on the minor thing. And the question is, what is the scale you can play on this chord? Well, you play the scale that it resolves on too, like D minor in this case. The chord, which is one semitone away, minor, harmonic minor. Okay, so I will just show you the effect that it creates, which is very nice. Well, there is one here, which is not very...
Cheat, you know, of game. So here I
have exactly the same example. This guy is Christian Jacob, he's a French, he's a very, very good pianist, he's in the States. And he does a solo on Route 66, it's a blues. It's a blues, so this is a blues in B flat. And he's doing interesting stuff, exactly the same kind. So he's adding chord and bowl.
So here we are at the final analysis of this tune, Matinali, which is fairly safe to say it's another tough tune. It's really up-tempo, as you know, and got a lot of chords.
Okay, I wanted to play this video at the beginning of the tutorial to show you that what's nice in jazz is that even when you don't understand jazz, you don't think it's true, but every single note is controlled. I mean, there is never any mistake by these guys. They do incredible stuff. They never do any mistake. And here he's playing the same. You see, it goes very fast. You see the score. There is no mistake. If you take all the notes, the strong beat, and you take the chords, which are all impossible chords, I don't know where you find all the things. There is never one single mistake. It's quite magical. You might listen to other kinds of music. Okay, that's a few seconds because it's a bit too much.
There's so many notes, but if I see something that I should bring attention to.
Yeah, also the front modulation, there's no single key there.
Rhythmic modulations, little phrase. Going up in thirds, modulating. Chromatic descending.
So it's just an example to show that some of these guys are really out in the world that I don't really, I mean, I don't go there really, but in fact it's too much because they lose the sense of tonality. And all this game is really, again, very thin line. You should do it a little bit, but in full control. Okay, now there is this, the nicest thing in there. It's called a side slip. Side slip is exactly this idea that, okay, I have to play on a chord sequence that's a bit boring, you know, or I want to show off my virtuosity. So I'm going to play something really out of tune. But then it's like the magician, and I'm going to do it, and you are going to hear, oh, this guy is really wrong, and then I will come back nicely and make this trick to you, and people who can hear it are really flabbergasted, I would say. But before I want to talk about that, I have to say something about why this was invented. So this was invented because there was a thing called modal jazz at some point in the 50s. You know, there's this record called Kind of Blue by Miles Davis, the bestseller record in jazz for some reason. And it's one of the records that I showed what was this thing with modal music. So the guy, I mean, Miles Davis was a bit bored with all these complex chord sequences. Actually, to be honest, Miles Davis was not a great virtuoso. I mean, he didn't like that. It was not his thing. So he started to say, well, it's a tune that's very simple, only one chord. Well, actually two. And this is this tune called So What. It's quite an interesting tune because it uses this chord, which is basically D minor, but played in a very, so you have to understand how it's played. You take a guitar, and you play just five first strings like this. So whatever, A, E, G, B. So it's a stack of fourths, except the last one. Because if you did a stack of fourths, you would do like, create something very special because then you can do this. Okay, so I play the thing and it lasts for some time. Most of the tunes there, which are authored by Miles Davis, actually were composed by Dido. Completely out of tune in action.
actually in the weak bound, in the weak, the strong beat, weak beat, more or less. So it's again this effect that, ooh, I made a mistake, but I follow my feet right. So what's hard to do in here is, you have to do it fast, because if you do it slowly, it becomes very dissonant and the ear does not forget about the trick. It thinks you are really out of tune. So it has to be very fast and you have to play the negotiate the coming back landing to the tonality. And this is really, I'm sorry, I tried to do it on the guitar, just on the same example, just to show you the kind of thing. So you play it.
Out of tune with D major.
major, and this is perfectly arriving to the point, to the target. And the nice thing is that this is exactly this, repeated one semitone up, and this is one semitone up. So the guy has sold 3 bars ahead. He said, I'm going to do something completely wrong, but I know that in 4 bars I will fall there. Of course, you have to be a bit aware and listen carefully for this kind of things. You could say, you could think it's only for nerds. That's fine. I'm a nerd, but this is about jazz. So let's do it again. And let's... show you is a great interpretation by Bjerregren of Still Stella by Starlight, and you can have a chord, you can look at them, and I will show you very interesting stuff. Thank you. cartoon substitution in a very nice way. So let's do a show we did. Come back. No one understands what's going on. I mean, when you hear the first time, and the improvisation only once, so I do it again. It's just a joke. He likes to make this kind of joke. It's driven there in a nice way, you know, and this is what it does all the time. So there is short intro that goes on F minor. We'll be right back. finding the idea, doing it right. So you know the thing, by the way. Okay, so it's incredible. I mean, there are lots of references here, and it works only if you know this game. Otherwise, it's absolutely uninteresting. Okay, I want to say a word about composing this stuff, because I have been recently switching my center of interest. I'm going slowly to the prime computer in ISMIR. Yeah. Well, the question is, you have a real book. Is it possible still to compose new standards, or everything is completely done? Like, is it possible still to compose new pop songs like the Beatles did as good? Or is it just something that the past and we are now in another era? Is this finished or not? I'm interested in those kinds of problems. And what's a nice call sequence for a standard? Should not be too simple, should not be too complex. So be nice to improvise on. It's a bit contradictory, because if it's nice to improvise, it should not be too complex, yet at the same time, you don't want things to jump too, always the same. So here's a tune I composed with a friend that's going to be released on CD. Just to show you, so the chord sequence is completely unusual. There is, well, I do some analysis, you know, the real book, you can show that this sequence locally has not gone wrong. But the trick is to find an interesting chord sequence with a melody that's extremely simple, that you can just stick in your ear, you know. So there is a balance to find between the, because the melody must be simple, but because you want to improvise on it. If it's a melody like Jack McLaughlin, where there are 600 notes per second, you cannot even play it right, you know, so you cannot even less improvise. So it's an example. I'm not saying it's a good example, but it's some kind of thing trying to do, and it creates new problems, actually, which are interesting. Thank you.
another formula thing for computer music. There is a guy called Longer Higgins, I don't know if you remember the guy that is a psychologist, who was one of the first tried to think about jazz as a machine, what kind of machine is needed to improvise in jazz. He made this claim that you didn't need any memory to produce a correct improvisation. It's true that if you do what he says, you can do a jazz system that improvises a melody on two chord sequence. I don't see how you can do all the references, the jokes and all that, if you don't have any memory. I mean, if you have memory already, it's very hard to do, but if you don't, okay. Obviously, it's an interesting problem, because this guy creates very complex, sophisticated objects, melodies and all that, and it's interesting to try to understand how they do. Well, I'm just going to go very, very fast on a project we have here. I'm going to do a state-of-the-art in the domain, so it should be done one day, probably. And I conclude on that. So the first thing is, there is this project called Virtuoso. I was trying to see, how can we model these Virtuoso, these guys who do all these incredible lines, in a very specific style. I mean, if you listen to Stefano Di Battista, you recognize his style. If you listen to Coltrane, you recognize his style. It's not at all random stuff. And it's not generated by a computer, you can hear it. And there is a nice thing, another model to do that. It's in the Markov model. It's very good to capture somehow statistical properties of sets of sequences. We all know that perfectly. And the Markov models are based on this hypothesis of amnesia. You don't need to have a memory of the past, which is very long, to model very well tonal music, especially for pitch, works for other dimensions. Okay, very fine. This is an old thing. The thing is, it's very nice, it's used a lot. For some reason, it has been used a lot also recently, more and more. But there is a fundamental problem that you cannot control anything with that. If you are a virtuoso, you are able to speed out a Markov chain very fast, okay, fine, but you are also able to control. What does it mean to control? Well, you want the last note of the sequence to be a C, for instance. And Markov models, because they don't have a memory by definition, it's completely incompatible with the idea of controlling, because controlling means, most of the time, establishing a relation between things which are not consecutive. Like, I want the last note to be the first note. I want the last chord to be the G7 to resolve the first chord, that kind of thing. This has nothing to do with my. So people who have tried to do that, usually what they do what we call it French bricolage, where they draw 2 million sequences and there must be one there which satisfies my constraint. And usually it works, but you have no guarantee. And in many cases it doesn't work. So what we have done is we try to typically to solve this problem right. And there are many situations where I do that, don't do that, like Gertrude, so I will not come back on that. We will show you examples, but just show you what examples of Gertrude for you. He writes exactly on the right note, and this phrase has never been played before. It's improvised, it's in his style, it's in the Gipsy style, it's completely controlled in terms of last note. Battista, Night in Tunisia, if you want to do that, you can build a Markov model, you cannot control it, especially with a sequence of that long, 20 notes, it's impossible. You can just try it random, that's all. And we have proposed, I will skip this, we don't have so much time. The basic idea technically is to say, okay, Markov model, the main interest is that it's very easy to estimate up the model from the corpus, and it's also very easy to generate a new sequence. It's basically random draw according to probabilities that you had before, so there is nothing more easier. But you cannot control. So what we have proposed is a new way to build Markov models, which is much more expensive. So you lose all the freedom of doing something fast, but the thing that you can put inside any kind of constraint. And the trick is to represent Markovianity as a constraint in the sense of constraint satisfaction.
So I will, it's a bit technical, I will not talk about that, there are lots of papers and that. I will just show you a stupid example that which I like. You take Charlie Parker again, you take all these chord sequences, the blues he has composed, like Blues for Alice I played before, but he has composed, I don't know, about 20 or 30. You build a Markov model of that. So there you will learn that after a B7, usually there is a E-flat major, for instance, that kind of thing. You know what is a Markov model. And then you say you want to compose a new blues in this time. Okay, already this is hard because the blues usually ends on the resolution of the first chord, so already you don't know that. Plus, my friend Boulez, always him again. You want 24 chords, which is 12 bars, 2 chords per bar, and they're all different. That becomes extremely hard because in the blues, I don't know if you have noticed, but you have lots of time the same chord repeated because otherwise you lose the sensation of the blues because of it. And so we can find this kind of thing and we can even give you the most probable one, that is the one which maximizes the probability of the Markov model from Charlie Parker. So it's interesting that you are in Charlie Parker's style, but you are really at the limit, on the fringe, on the outer limits. And you can do this with arbitrary constraints. So this is the result. Right. And of course, it's not a nice blues. I will play it, it's terrible. It is impossible to play on that. It's a textbook case, but it is a blues, start by C, end by G7, it's fine. Second night start by F, like a blues. You know, blues, usually C, 1-9, F, and then back to C, something like that. All this is fine. And all the transitions are very probable in the Charlie Parker, and this, if you compute the product of probabilities, it's the highest you can find, which satisfies this thing. I will play it just to show you that it's not a good example.
Thank you.
can virtuosity be put in the hands of people who cannot spend their life trying to do that? And indeed, well, the answer is yes. Well, the problem now is more to integrate this in a real instrument, not to do a demo. And the Wii mode is very, very hard to program. It's very inaccurate. So we need other experiments with other controller. I will skip a little bit about it. So another interesting question is not only the virtuosity, but the fact of playing together with a band. It's very interesting. You are interacting all the time with what is called the rhythm section. The guys are very important because they provide their harmonic and rhythmic foundation. And if they do a good job, you can just focus on your improvisation, play with the right note. And otherwise, you can, by the way, Louis Armstrong was very inventive. He created probably jazz, I mean, somehow. And one of the reasons is because he had a terrible rhythm section. They were very bad. And so he had to, in his improvisation, to emphasize all the time the root and the third. And this is why his choruses are so perfect. You can sing them without harmony, which is very hard. I mean, try to do that without harmony, you understand? So anyway, so the rhythm section is very important. It's a very interesting problem for computer scientists because they all have their different style. They react to each other, they listen, but yet they have to follow the grid. And if you play hard and fast, they have to follow you, but yet do their stuff a lot. So it's a complex, interesting problem. So well, this is a real band in action, you know? Semi-final in the international song competition. I'm very proud. It's better than ISMIR. We should have something like that, ISMIR. Competition about content. It's interesting, we listen to each other a lot, we don't look at each other. No one is looking at each other at all. It's just sound. So just through sound listening, we try to adapt to each other. So the problem was, how can we do it? And another way, how can we model it? Another way to look at it is to look at other songs in minus one recordings. Obviously, if you play with another song.
One, two, one, two, three.
You play fast, you play hard, you play soft, whatever. Of course, it's a recording, it's not going to change. It's not a rhythm section, but it is something that is in there. Well, I need to explain to you why it does not change. But you see the thing is we'd like to have something like that, but that reacts and adapts to you, but yet follow this start, step by start, or whatever. So, we go fast, but we try to use the standard of concatenation synthesis. So we record a musician, a bass player, we record a drummer, a piano comping or guitar comping, different kinds of situations, create databases, then we try to use these things in real time to do an accompaniment. And of course, it's not enough to say, well, I am in E7 right now. I will take a bit of bass that was in E7. That's it. No, it has to fit well the way I play. It has to fit whatever you have played before. I mean, it's fine. It's not just random stuff. So, for instance, this is a solo by sax solo by Ed Jones. And this is what you could do with concatenative synthesis, just focusing on harmony. Sorry. Well, so it's not very good, although harmonically it's perfect. And so something better, which we can do with faster, slower, and then more energy, more whatever, it also follows you. And so, just demo of the system kind of ideas, so it's based on features, so I think that you understand what is the feature as well, but the idea that the virtual agent here, drummer,
can understand a channel where you say more of this feature when some energy loudness or heat comes. So this is with a joystick, I will show you the real instrument. And the idea that you can control these arbitrary features. Production, And it's very interesting. It's completely different problems, exactly the same context, exactly the same techniques at the end, but the questions are very different. How do you compose a melody on which people can improvise themselves? There are many interesting questions there. I do it for music composition, also improvisation, and also text writing. We have already interesting results using remarkable symbolism. Anyway, it's very nice, very interesting. My problem is that I'm looking for people, good students, good programmers, good postdocs, good invited professors, whatever. Okay. You want to work on this subject in Paris for 1 year, 2 years, three, four, five. You are good. Well, a little bit less because it started last month. It's really hard to recruit people, and I don't understand the world. There is a world crisis, no money, but there is all this money for us. It's great. But then there is a shortage of people, and all the people that died have so many people. Okay, and there are lots of questions for me, and the point I wanted to make at the beginning, but first I wanted to get you interested in jazz, but actually I'm not so sure that many of you didn't know anything about jazz, for apparently many of you knew, so maybe it wasn't wrong. But the key point for me was to say, well, you have to know about all these things if you want to build an interesting MIR system. When I say MIR system, it's a system that would ease the access problem. You know, I don't care about similar stuff, team running. I mean, I'm not going to criticize this, I do a lot of it also, but I'd like to have the same where there is someone playing out of the harmony. I'd like to have all 2-5-1s in minor by minor by Pierre Gagarin. I want to have interesting voicings for chords. I want to detect all the musical borrowings, you know, when is this tune being used in the chorus. I want to know who is doing the chorus in the back in the Lucia John McLaughlin trio. It's very hard to know. I know because I've listened to this since for the last 25 years, so I kind of know who is playing, but it's very hard, a very interesting problem. If you know already that these guys are playing, it's maybe easier, but if you don't know who is playing, and you know in the jazz, Joe Form made this remark, the old records, it was not written who is playing, apart from the main guy. Even Miles Davis records are not very clear sometimes who is playing. So there is a very interesting problem, style recognition, of course, or mixed with source separation, maybe, I don't know, but there are lots of questions. My point was not to tell you what to do, was to say, if you want to do things which are relevant, you have to understand the game, otherwise it doesn't make really any sense. But then there are deep questions, like the one I'm trying to ask, okay, what is a good solo, a good performance, I have no idea, I just gave you some examples, some hints, but I mean, I don't know. Good rhythm section, that kind of thing is very interesting because now the market of, as you know, I mean the market music industry basically does not exist anymore, but the market of music pedagogy is huge and it's booming. Market of music and instrument is incredible, it's booming, it's exploding. The question is no longer how to put all these millions of songs together, but it's how to help people to compose new ones. But with this ideas in head, I mean, we have all the things in the past that we want to reuse in some way. So there are lots of, I think, interesting questions there. Summarize, if you want to know everything about jazz, it's one line. Take a major scale, you have a scale tone chord, then you have a set of good notes. Then this is telling you which scale are right, that's it. Then you just practice. But then once you do that, you have a lot of very subtle games, you know, very, very subtle that take place. And these are the things we want to look for. We don't care about how many wrong notes the guy has played in the end. And of course, well, we want to do all that. So there is we are quite far away from the system that do that, but my thing is that it's interesting to go there. And at the end, it's just a bit like, yeah, what the community should be. We all quote each other and also improve. It's very, very nicely, very still evolving field for all these reasons. So I gave you a questionnaire that, if you don't mind, I will send you a mail in 1 month or whatever, or something like that. And you will tell me, well, you already all know. Well, if you have three everywhere, then I can't do anything for you. Maybe I can make it disgusted. I'd like to know, the point was, you know, if you think about starting a series of why this is interesting, why jazz is interesting, why pop is interesting, why hard rock is interesting, that kind of thing. Because if you explain to people why it's interesting, then, you know, it's a mere thing you achieve. You get the long tail effect and what people then are interested by. I'm not interested in So, okay, don't hesitate, give me all sorts of comments. It's the third time I do this, usually it's much shorter. I think 1 hour is better than 3, but I would like to improve it and maybe see how to make it more general, apply to other domains. So please criticize me as much as you can, but not too hard, but I'm not looking for compliments. Okay, thanks a lot.
The little pleasures or the great pleasures you derive. So as a saxophone player, one of the aspects that was not mentioned at all is articulation in your tutorial, and sort of micro timing, rhythm, articulation, and all these incredible, and in some ways a lot of your examples do not have that. Maybe the Miles Davis is an example where it's very subtle, but when you know
when
you play fast, it kind of disappears. So that's just a kind of criticism in a sense that it's another incredible dimension of subtlety that. And what happens also when playing is it becomes so second nature that you don't realize that if you give that line to like a classical player, it won't sound right because you have your used to kind of playing. The other thing is just the mechanics of the instrument. So I was wondering, at least sound-wise, you can tell transcribe MIDI solo from a trumpet player versus a saxophone player. Guitar is very symmetric. It's probably the best one to do side slips and chord substitutions. But do you think that it would make sense to have some kind of mechanical difficulty or mechanical constraint model in these things?
To make things sound more human.
Yeah, sure.
I mean, yeah, sure. Why not?
In sort of your constraint satisfaction or...
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's only, the beginning, I think. You know, just probably always has to be thrown away. I don't know, but it's just trying to go in that direction. And you are absolutely right. Expression, but also sound. I mean, sax player, they are mostly concerned with their sound.
Yeah.
Once they got the basic techniques. I don't talk about it, but it's,
And also just the uniqueness of it, like you can
tell a
certain saxophone player from...
I'm sorry, I agree with you, so I can't argue. Yes?
First, I want to say, awesome story. I think you would see something more focused on music theory, especially jazz. In terms of your big question, what is a good solo? I'm not sure we can answer that. I'm not sure a musician can answer that.
We need a deep question.
But one thing, one idea I had listening to this was this idea of jokes or, citing each other or borrowing licks. I think, trying to detect that would be a cool problem. Perhaps that could give you some indication of musical influence, if you're borrowing licks from each other. And obviously, that'd be really hard. And in terms of musical variation, we could change it a lot. You could change the key. You could change the tempo. Yeah. You can change some of the ordering, and we'd still perceive it as a citation.
Yeah.
So that's a hard problem, but I don't know. I just wanted to see what you think about that.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, there are lots of things to try. I don't know, but do it. I mean, I'm not going to do all this, but I think these are interesting problems because they are related. Fundamentally, not the problem of where can I find something that I like, which is the thing that we have been working on for the last, 10, 15 years, but what can I do myself? And this is a different problem, but I think it's more important today given the state of the society. But you're right, I mean, all these questions are interesting. Your point.
I think what is interesting is that it could somehow highlight what we're talking about in ISMIR. It's about what is specific to music, which is the art notes, musical notes, that's what we said in ISMIR. And the other thing, that's what you talk about, the other thing which I think is put to my face is that the other thing you somehow talk about is instrument and player. that, and I somehow agree with George in the fact that actually all music are not played by all kind of musicians. So far in the Maillard, we have only one instrument, which is singing voice, and the rest is what we name background music, our companion. In instrumental music, we have a leader or several leaders, and usually it's a set of leaders that play together, and one is playing a chorus, and then the other one plays the accompaniment. That's really interesting, because somehow, corresponding to George, what George said, you give a point of view which is somehow the point of view of a guitar player,
yeah.
And which is can somehow be also the point of view of pianist player, because both are visually instruments. You play saxophone, I play trumpet, so we don't share the same point of view on improvisation, yeah. But that doesn't care. It also highlights then what can we do. If you want to do learning for musicians, then we need several representation models. If you want to do an application that somehow helps people to understand what jazz is interesting, it's another application. But somehow it also changed because we did some studies recently about something which is really familiar when you do automatic key detection or chord detection. Is you say there is no prior when you have a musical track, there is no prior about the key in which the track is. But it's not true at all. If you analyze the content of the real book, there are huge prior on the key, which if it is coming from a guitar, it will be E,
yeah.
B, or A. And that's the prior, there are prior. If it's if you look at most track from Charlie Parker, that will be B flat or A flat. So there are huge connection between the kind of chords that are used and the key that is used in the instrument,
yeah.
And also the kind of musical phrase that you can play with an instrument.
Yeah.
The phrase is, you don't play at all. Billy Lagan can play very fast because it's a guitar. A saxophone can play in a specific way, and the rest, they are also mechanical notes, right?
Absolutely.
And that also, I think, creates really new subject of research.
It's
better take the physical constraint of the player, the instrument. So thank you, it's really good.
I'm sorry, I agree with all of you, I can only fight.
Yeah, 6 hours already.
Yeah. By the way, you said voice, I didn't talk about voice, you talk about trumpet. I mean, yeah, please do it. I mean, we deny that, you know, some people try to do this exercise. I mean, it took more time than I expected because of the timing. I didn't realize about 3 hours, but I think it's an interesting exercise to, because it forces you to identify what is the target in the end, what is really interesting. By doing this, I mean, all these things with side slips are kind of second nature, but then I realized that we're absolutely crucial by doing this exercise of, you know, if I have to tell someone what is important. So it would be interesting to have the same for hard rock or techno, I mean, by people who are reasonable, let's say. The goal is not, okay, this is great because look at that, I love it. Find some argument, but I think you can always do it somehow. Yeah, sorry. Yes.
Yeah, no, it's actually, I was going to say that anyway, but since that's the right moment. Because I think actually what you told us is mostly what's great about music and not just about jazz. Of course, there's more improvisation in jazz than in other genres, but I think the idea of reworking stuff from previous composers and stuff, it's very, you know, there's lots of jokes and sort of half jokes in classical music.
Yeah, of course.
In popular music also.
Yes.
So, and it depends kind of on the, I mean, there's also music that's not supposed to be kind of listened to attentively. There's some music that's made to dance to.
Yes, absolutely.
But then I find that in whatever genre you get into, you find almost exactly what you presented us about jazz, really. You find like jokes, you find there's what's it coming together again and so.
It would be interesting to have the viewpoint of someone in a completely different genre. I am thinking about hard rock, because hard rock is not only going there to take ecstasy. I mean, it's partly because of that. But also, there is a real musical pleasure. I mean, I'm not expert, but I know it's true. I would be interested to have. And then, you will highlight other dimensions which are completely different from hard rock is not about side slips, really. But it's about other things which are interesting.
It's not
But then the question is about the analog is what we need for the listeners or the players, because we have music in analog, they are using a musical scale like pigeon scale, which are pretty close to jazz scale, because they sound very really hard of tune. But the point of view of the listeners will be quite different. So here's some more you what is specific to jazz is that you give the example of the girlfriend going to the concert and she does not understand why to get excited about this C flat augment that he used or stuff like that. But one thing which is specific to jazz is that many people that are listening to jazz, that like to listen to jazz, they like it because they are also practicing. Now what it may be different. So because the point of view you provide is mostly the point of view of the players.
Yeah, it kind of leads. It's a big dirty. I mean, it's not keen, it's not clear, but it's an attempt. I wanted to try. So yeah, you're completely right. This film is not a vision.
But don't you think these problems would be more interesting in the technical hard knot, I mean, versus like four chords on, I mean, not really a knot to learn from those where, you know, like a little page or something like that, and you could probably take a lot away from them, just like you could with jazz. I mean, rock really is derived from jazz, just like funk and blues and hip hop, I mean, some level, early jazz.
Yeah, there is something different between rock and jazz. I mean by that if rock was simply derived from jazz music, then jazz music you have 200 people for 200 chords in a track, and in rock you have 4,100 people, 400,000 people for two chords. So there is something also interesting in rock. Actually, it's the same thing which is interesting. But I mean, many people are listening to rock music, so there must be also something interesting.
I think also there's a Facebook thing that says jazz players dress like millionaires and don't make a lot of money, and rock musicians dress like homeless people that make millions. But there is definitely a social aspect which we kind of tend to ignore, and hard rock is very theatrical too. There's a lot of costumes and masks and behavior that's involved. Jazz, I guess, is less about that for sure.
My question, my comment actually, is more about accessibility of material. So it seems pop music is widely accessible. Use a lot of the more sophisticated elements you're talking about.
Yeah.
But as it gets more sophisticated, jazz is less accessible just because people don't get it. I mean, they don't relate to it necessarily. So, and I have a bit of a problem with the jazz classification, I mean, from a genre standpoint, but, you know, there are elements that you're talking about used less sparingly, more sparingly, in more accessible music. And then there seems to be like going to a niche point where, you know, the group really shrinks. And there's stylistic things in between that, you know, it's a no-no to kind of cross that. But there's probably an area between the two where you can get a bigger audience with, you know, less sophisticated kind of thing, using similar things and, you know, genre-dependent, of course, it could be, you know, coming from different genres. So what's your take on that? Is it possible to kind of create a genre in between these two that's going to be more accessible?
Yeah, it's a strange question, but I like it. First, I was not looking for popularity coming here, but I think a lot of people, I was not trying to oversell jazz. It's like the Jewish religion, you know, it's not proselytism, you know. If you don't like it, that's fine. Jazz, you don't need a big audience. But then your question is actually different. It's now the question is not how to make jazz very popular. I mean, it's not possible. But the question is really touches upon what I tried to show at the end. I mean, how do you compose a tune which is popular, that's sticky, that then gets into your ear? Of course, you can say it's just marketing. I don't think it's only marketing. It's probably partially that, but it's also other things which are strictly musical, and which we could at least try to talk about. Although it's very hard. For instance, next year, I mean, I could try, if it's
except that good to tie up on why pop is interesting for me. But trying to emphasize this question of how to compose a tune that sticks in your head, forgetting as much as you can the social aspect, the style, the system aspect, of course, it's hard. But I think it's a related question to pop, because for pop, the audience, the size of the audience is crucial, whereas for jazz, it's a bit another thing you're trying to do. For jazz, you're trying to convince a small bunch of people that what you do is great. So the goals are different. But I'm very, how could you create a style, which is more sophisticated, yet more, very good question. I have no idea how to do that.
Yeah, related to this, I think it's not just a technical interest in this improvising that you're following there. You should also like track your music emotion. Yeah. And what this improvisation, what's the influence on people. So maybe this could be a hybrid pop and...
Yeah, I have a problem with emotions. I mean, I don't have a problem having emotions. I have a problem with emotion studies. Because it seems to me that emotions come from that and not the reverse. Yeah. Not that you have emotion and then you say, oh, it's a side thing. It works like that. But it seems to me that the emotions come from an effect that's produced somehow in your ear. And I was not trying to address at all, because it's so difficult and it's so obviously there, but we don't know how. I was trying just to focus on the thing that we can try to explain some of the mechanics.
Yeah, but you're interested in seeing what the effect of some atonal.
No, but these questions are very interesting, and I don't think they have been studied really well yet. And, it's one of the thread of things.
Yeah, and the second thing, maybe my friends here from the Camp Music can talk more about they're studying Indian music, so I think that the same mechanism could be applied to raga.
It would be nice, it's possible. Yeah, we have a small book, it's nice, it's probably, it would be interesting to study that. The role of his team is very interesting. I don't care.
This what you're saying, do you believe that we could take into account this lower level dimensions of, let's take the jazz framework. You have a set of rules between brackets, and then you deviate from it or create some structure over it, and then this creates some situations that are, it's smaller, it's more lower level. And once you have this model and well understood, then you could build some model upon it to, I don't know, make it inside of a framework, inside of a culture, then exploit emotions. Do you think this would be something more logical then?
Maybe, No, emotions, should be studied the right way. But maybe it's... I don't know why you're asking me. I have no idea how... you're probably right. I don't know. It's good if I can start this kind of discussion, but I'm not the guy who can answer all that. Okay,
I have a question on the way you, I guess, slightly immortalized the human players.
Yeah.
You said that the Markov thing doesn't work because it's got no memory. And then you talked about this way that people prepare a note 3 bars in advance. To what extent are they really improvising when they're doing that? And to what extent is that... Because humans also have a finite memory.
Absolutely.
And finite planning ability. And it seems to me to get suspicious the longer these sequences are.
The extreme example of Aldimola's side slip, which is 3 bars before, is very clearly the plan 3 bars ahead, but it's probably not very frequent.
It is
absolutely important. Oh yeah, this. I mean, I'm not. You should ask him, of course. I didn't do it, but I cannot imagine, because it has never been done before. I mean, these guys, they have done these concerts for I think 15 years, and they're all different. So, I didn't listen to everything. I didn't do the study that would be accepted in the paper. But I don't think so. I mean, I think I've never heard Aldimora doing this before. So I guess, but you're right, I mean, the human memory is not infinite, it's probably quite short, actually. But in the paper, I quoted somewhere, I wrote a paper about the virtuosity, because I'm interested in virtuosity as a field, actually, a study. What are virtuoso? I don't know what it is. It's a very good book, very important book you should buy, just published by Springer on computers and creativity. I wrote a chapter on virtuosity. I think it's a very interesting problem. Creativity is very hard, you don't even know really what it is. But virtuosity is easier to define. And my problem was, okay, what is a virtuoso? It's not only someone who can do stuff fast. It's also someone who thinks very fast. And I made a claim that the virtuoso is interesting for me because he's basically an NP problem solver. He's not only playing fast, he's doing stuff that are really hard to do combinatorially. And so, so you're right, there is a human memory is spinning. But it's also, we try to imitate humans, but we also try to do new stuff. It's not very clear the role of human activity there. It's more kind of, taking inspiration for doing new things rather than trying to actually model how humans work. But, we have a giant memory for sure. But we can work out. I mean, Jerry Lagrène, the story is he played guitar all the time when he was a child, like all the time. Like when he went to the toilet, he took his guitar with him, that kind of thing. So he has probably developed in his head somewhere, somehow, a model of all the scales and paths and all that, which is extremely powerful. It would be interesting to know what kind of model he has. Tell us things about also the music system. How to do that? Yeah, I can talk for hours. I don't want to prevent those who are tired to leave. But,
Maybe you should do just like Bernstein did young people's concerts, but for jazz. Or
what do you mean? Sorry.
You know young people's concerts by Bernstein for classical music, where he gave this talks. Concerts,
oh, yeah,
young people.
Ah,
you could do the same for jazz.
Yeah, well, why not? But you could do also. I mean, anyone could do it. Yeah, it's a bit tiring to do. It does not increase my age index. No, it's very interesting for me to have your reactions. The question more is more like, can it be sustained, improved, applied to other domains? That kind of thing. It'd be interesting. I think everybody's tired, no? We have to drink wine, 6 o'clock. Thank you very much.